Welcome and good afternoon. On behalf of UNE and the Department of Business, I'd like to welcome everybody here today for the 8th annual Paul D. Merrill Business Ethics Lecture. Before we start, I'd like to just mention a couple things. The first is that when the Q&A session starts 45 minutes into the lecture, please be patient and wait till you have a microphone in your hand before you ask the question. And myself and another student will be bringing the microphones to where you're at. And secondly, after the lecture is over, everybody is invited to the UNE Art Gallery, which is at the back of the campus, for a reception and a gathering. So at this time, I'd like to bring UNE President Dr. Danielle Rippich to the podium. Thank you.
Good afternoon, and thank you, Professor Daly. It's really my pleasure also to welcome you here to celebrate the legacy of our dear friend and trustee, P.D. Merrill. I think of P.D. actually every day. I sit at the desk that was his father's, and he gave it to me when I arrived here at UNE 9 years ago. And so P.D.'s been sort of helping me along in this journey as the presidency. This is the 8th annual P.D. Merrill Lecture, as Michael just said, and this is something that, as I look back and think about the speakers, the range of speakers we've had, the wisdom that they've brought, I am really grateful that we have this amazing program. And the reason that we have it is because of Sandy Goulden, PD's wife and a longtime member of our Board of Trustees. Sandy and their son Ethan and all of our board members and former board members who are with us here today, I would really like to express the gratitude on behalf of the university for your support and support of the lecture. So thank you so much. We are really fortunate to have the Merrills as part of our UNE family. I'd like to also welcome our faculty and staff and students here. As students, I would just want to say, whether you aspire to a career in business or another field, you are the next generation of leadership for our society. Your values, your daily decisions, your actions will shape the future world. And your lives will have, as they already do, a cascading effect of impacting others. PD understood the importance of this cascading and connection that we all share. He lived his life ever mindful of the positive role that he could play in uplifting others. We share this commitment at UNE, I am proud to say, and as a private university, I believe we really sustain a very public mission in Maine and in New England. We are committed to civic responsibility, and we understand, as PD did, that living with a mindset that makes our own lives so much more meaningful as we connect with others. When PD was a young man, he traveled to Washington a little over 50 years ago to hear the "I Have a Dream" speech by Martin Luther King. And I believe that that speech had a major impact on him because he emerged from that experience inspired to help others and went to Leslie County, Kentucky, the real hills of Kentucky and Appalachia, as a volunteer. He built houses, he built a school, he spent 2 years there living with the community and putting his time and some sweat equity into his own beliefs. He later came back to Maine, rose in the business world, but he never forgot that commitment of giving back throughout his life. And that brings us to today's speaker, Kevin Hancock. Mr. Hancock has had a life that I know would please P.D. Merrill. As president of Hancock Lumber Company, he leads a sixth-generation family business that has operated in Maine since 1848. I just have to say that number again. That's really an incredible record for a family business since 1848. It's headquartered in Casco, and the company has 10 retail stores, 3 sawmills. It employs a little over 425 people It owns and manages 12,000 acres of Maine forest for us, and it's really a lot of responsibility. And I have no doubt that Mr. Hancock has felt that responsibility, and yet he still found time and energy to dedicate a significant portion of his life to assisting others. He regularly travels to Pine Ridge Reservation in South Dakota. This is one of the poorest regions in America, and he works there with the residents. And he's created a nonprofit to support that work that's called the Seventh Power. And I think we'll hear a little more about that today. He is also working on a book entitled Not for Sale, Finding Myself in the Land of Crazy Horse. That is really the story of modern life of the Ogallala Sioux tribes that are in that region of South Dakota. Mr. Hancock understands the difference we can make in the lives of others and the importance of taking our time to do so. He understands that our efforts are magnified still further when we connect with like-minded people to do this work and work together. Indeed, he is a businessman, a Maine businessman, of whom our friend P.D. Merrill would surely be proud. So please join me in welcoming our speaker for the P.D. Merrill Business Ethics Lecture, Kevin Hancock, speaking to us today. Thank you.
Oh, thanks so much. I always prefer to be down here. So I bet we all here have a lot of things that make us different, and I bet we have a lot of things that make us the same. One notion we probably share is our love for the state of Maine and all its quirkiness, everything about it, right? It's what you love about Maine. So it's in that spirit that I'm gonna say this. You know you're in Maine when the lecture series speaker is the guy from the local lumber company. I mean, seriously, think about that. Where else does that happen? So the P.D. Merrill Lecture Series is a really special and important series. And I want to just start by saying thank you. I'm honored to have been invited. I must confess, in the months leading up to today, I was blissfully naive about the event. I started asking a few weeks ago the organizers to tell me more about it, and so I said, well, what, do you do this monthly or quarterly, or how does this work? The phone got quiet, and then Michael said, no, it's annually. We do this once a year. I was like, oh. Like, I'm the speaker for this year. I better pay attention. I better get organized, and I better do a good job. And I really do want to do all of that. So then I took a closer look at the mission of the lecture series, and I love it. I love the mission. You probably know it, but it's really powerful and valuable. Couple of excerpts. Ethical considerations in our daily choices. I love that notion. Exploring the role that good business practices can play in the health of a community. The mission of this lecture series is needed, it's important, it's powerful. Just curious, who here knew P.D. Merrill? Yeah, I love that. I love that. So I knew him really well. He was a very good friend of mine and a very important mentor to me. He served on our board of directors, the first real outside independent fiduciary board of directors in the history of our company that we created shortly after my dad died. And P.D., and one of his many buddies, Angus, the Angus King, were the two people we were able to recruit. We were so fortunate. And Petey and Angus were the best together. They would just wind each other up and play off each other and leverage each other. So my dad died. My dad was the fifth generation leader of our company. He died very young at the age of 54 in 1997, and very young at the age of 32 in 1998, I became president of our company. Which, as 32-year-olds think, I thought I was perfectly ready for and that it would be easy. I really did. So I've been blessed because I kind of survived so far learning about what it really takes. But thanks in large part to people like, and specifically to P.D. Merrill. I will never forget P.D. Merrill as a person and have great respect for him. And any forum, in my view, including this one, that honors PD, and those of you that know him will just nod your head when we look at this, should, this is what it should be. It should be fun. Like this hour, this should be fun. It should involve laughter. It should be spirited. It should be inquisitive. It should be ethical, passionate, thoughtful, and it should definitely challenge the status quo. It should think a little bit differently. PD, in my view, was always just the right distance ahead of the curve. Just the right distance ahead of the curve. When I think of PD, I have this quote is up on our office wall. And Alexander Graham Bell said it, but PD could have said, he could have been talking about PD Merrill. An inventor is a man or a woman who looks around the world and is not content with the way things are. That was PD, among many other things. So shortly, I'll tell you a quick story. Shortly after PD joined our board, he built a barn at his house. And the contractor that was going to build the barn didn't use did not normally use Hancock Lumber. They used another supplier, who shall not be named. And so PD had to persuade the builder to use Hancock Lumber, which they did. So, and everything went fine. But the barn was finished, and PD called me one day when it was about done, and he said, "The next time you come through Portland, stop by. I want to show you something." So I said, "Okay, great." So I go to Portland, go down to the terminal, you know, credentials and hard hat, and get in and go to his office and sit down in his big office. And he pulls out a stack of papers, like this thick, and he drops them on his desk. The stack is so thick it makes a sound when it hits. He doesn't say anything. So I said, "Well, what's that?" He said, "Those are my invoices from Hancock Lumber for just this barn." And he said, "This doesn't make sense to me." He said, "You have no idea how many times your trucks came to this job site. You have no idea how many invoices I was mailed. And this can't be the best, most efficient way to do things." And that's where PD always was. He was always challenging, thinking about how things could be done differently and better. But at the same time, he was like, he reminds me a little bit of Angelo Dundee, who was Muhammad Ali's trainer. Because even though he challenged you, you always knew he was still in your corner. He was not challenging you for any other reason but to be in your corner. And that's such a great blend. And it allows you to be helped. So, a lecture series. Just talk about things that are unique in this day and age. The very existence of a lecture series has become a rarity. And what does the notion of a lecture series represent? for me, it represents time to stop, time to think, to reflect, and to sit still. All of which I feel are increasingly becoming rare commodities. So one of my favorite quotes is this one. It's really easy in business, in the lumber business, it's really easy to be busy. It's really hard to be successful. And it's important not to confuse being busy with being successful. But even more importantly, I've morphed this quote into a broader thought about the modern age, which is don't confuse being busy with living. Because I feel like in my own experiences, I've walked that line. So Hancock Lumber in a pine cone, not in a nutshell, but in a pine cone. Just real quick for some context. A bit has been covered, but so our company, but it's worth thinking about. Our company began doing business in 1848. My first job after I went to Lake Region High School and then Bowdoin College, and then I taught history, American and Russian history, and coached basketball at Bridgton Academy. So the way I always think about 1848 is well before the first cannonball was fired in the Civil War, before that happened, Hancock Lumber was in business in Casco and has been in business from Casco, owned by the same family, in the same industry, uninterrupted ever since. And I don't ever take that for granted because that's not normal. I've always wanted, if you could go to the place where those records are and look at everything that was incorporated in 1848, it might just be us left. Don't know, but not normal. So 435 employees, 10 stores, 3 sawmills. We're the largest manufacturer in North America of eastern white pine products, and then about 12,000 acres of timberland. Our largest customer is Lowe's. I love this. So we supply every Lowe's store from Bangor to North Carolina on the East Coast, over 400 stores, with a resource, white pine that grows naturally in Maine and abundantly, for which all the manufacturing value is added here. I just love that. We export product all over the world, 20% of what we make. We ship to other countries, and of all the businesses we're in, I think perhaps my favorite, because it's the one that makes the least sense, is that we grow pine trees. It makes no sense. So it takes 80 to 100 years to grow one. So think about that. We've been in business since before the Civil War, and we've had 2 crops. So I have a friend who, we have a friend who owns a farm stand on the other side of town. Go there often. And I'm so jealous because she grows like pumpkins and corn. And I'm like, wait, you mean like you plant these in the spring and you harvest them in the fall? Oh my word, that's unbelievable. But you couldn't be in the business of growing pine trees without taking kind of a long-term view, just because of the nature of how long it takes to actually grow a pine tree. And I'm proud to be a part of the 6th generation of my family to work for this company. And the most important word to me in that sentence is for. Because that's how I think about it. Hancock Lumber does not work for me. It's not there to serve me. It did just fine before I ever showed up. And my job is to try to help for a short period of time in the eye of the history of this company, keep it reinventing itself and vibrant and healthy and moving forward. It's a caretaker role. It's a temporary role. Because when an organization, whether it's the University of New England or Hancock Lumber, when an organization hits a certain age or endurance. It gains a life of its own that's bigger than just what can it do here and now for the people that own it here and now. It's bigger than that. Its value is broader than that. And it serves a group that's far larger than that. And that's how I think about our company. Okay, here's kind of my first thought that I want to share in terms of the ideas today that I want to talk about. It's a really simple thought, but I think it's a powerful one, and I've actually been thinking a lot about it. I find myself thinking the most about the simplest thoughts, not the most complicated thoughts, because even though simple thoughts are simple, it doesn't mean they aren't powerful. So here's the thought. We all come from a tribe. Well, of course, I didn't need to come to a lecture series to know that, right? But think about it, we all come from a tribe. What's the tribe? That's the house, the family, the neighborhood, the street, the state, the region, the country, the community that you were raised in. We all come from a tribe, and that tribe pulls on us to think in certain ways, to act in certain ways, and to do certain things. And I think it's important to be aware of that, to reflect on the tribe we come from and how that tribe influences us. Because I also believe that the journey of living, the soul's journey of living, is to transcend and individuate and find its true callings and passions and endeavors. Not to leave the tribe we come from, not to love the tribe we come from any less, but to serve ourselves and the life that we really want to live. So think a little bit about my tribe in a broad sense. So my tribe would be, from a business sense, would be the forest products industry in Maine, which is a tribe historically of what I refer to as rugged individualism, which really kind of translated into how the forest products industry has traditionally worked, means at work, the more I suffer, the better I'm doing. The earlier I get up, the colder it is, the more splinters I get, the more my back hurts, the later I get home, the more I suffer. That's how I prove my commitment. It's just an industry that comes from that ethos of rugged individualism, which like any thought is beautiful and difficult at the same time. It's never one or the other, it's both. But in the spirit of P.D. Merrill, in the spirit of questioning the status quo, I've started to rethink that premise of whether or not that should be the measurement of commitment to a company or the way you prove your commitment to a business. In the spring of 2001, to take this forward, Hancock Lumber had its first lean manufacturing event. So we, and I was there at our Bethel planing mill for 3 days, we learned about lean manufacturing, process improvement, modern day efficiency, Toyota business model style, fast, accurate, waste eliminating, focus on the customer, how to be a lean organization. And lean can mean a lot of things to a lot of different people, but to me, this is what it means. This is what it's come to mean for me, that lean, that notion of being a lean organization, is about empowering every member of the team to eliminate waste, focus on the customer, in a continuous improvement mode that never finishes, and then the big point I've added on the end is for the benefit of everyone. Not just the business, not just for making more money, but for everyone in the system. Everyone that works there, all the customers, all the suppliers, everyone. Lean is for the benefit of everyone. And being lean in a modern way is a far cry from the way the lumber industry traditionally functioned. There was an old saying in the lumber business, which I've actually heard in my time at our company. And you know, old sayings become old sayings because they're partially funny, but they're also kind of true. That's why they stick, because it's actually how things work. There was an old saying in the lumber business that went like this. Ship, as in sell, ship them what they want, what the customer wants. Sell them what they want. Ship them what you've got. Sell them what they want. Ship them what you've got. And that was really how sawmills functioned. The customer was a distant, distant thought. Sell them what they want, ship them what you got. But we got into lean, and we really, really got into lean, and it revolutionized our company. And 14 years later, it's amazing the differences that it has made for us. I'll give you just two quick examples. So this chart is showing rework. So in our stores, contractors call, they place an order for building materials, we deliver it to a construction site. In 2006, 10% of the time, there was something wrong with that order. So there was too much product, not enough product, the price wasn't right, it wasn't billed correctly, something had to come back. And we went to work on that diligently, with the people in our organization who do the work and directly with our customers and suppliers. And last year, less than 4% of the time, rework was involved. So we eliminated rework by over 60%. And if you say in a business setting, raise your hand if you enjoy rework, nobody raises their hand. If you sit with people in a safe environment and say, how does rework make you feel? They say, it makes me stressed. I don't like it. Makes me uncomfortable. It doesn't benefit anybody. It's wasted time. That's the kind of thing lean is designed to eliminate. And then here's another example. This example is really dramatic too. So we got looking. This is right back to that story about P.D. Merrill's barn. So he kind of started this, and he would love this chart. So we got looking a few years ago at how many times we were delivering to a job site. And to supply a normal home, like a Cape or a Colonial, a new home, we might be delivering there 50, 60, 70 times. In the name of outstanding customer service, ironically. So when we started asking around, well, why are we going there 50, 60, 70 times? The answer was, well, because the builder asked us to. So the notion was, anytime you need anything, just call us and we'll stop what we're doing and we'll run out there, and that's how we'll prove rugged individualism. That's how we'll prove our love for you. And of course, there'll always be emergencies when we do need to stop and run, but it shouldn't be the ideal state goal. So we started talking to our builders and our sellers and our logistics managers about, well, what if we could make fewer deliveries? What if instead of coming to a job site 60 times, we came 30? And cut the trips in half, cut the job site interruptions in half, cut the invoices in half. Who would win? And what we found is that everybody would win. The customer would win and we would win. So last year we delivered about $64 million worth of products on our trucks to job sites for builders in Maine. And it took us 15,587 trips to do that, a truck leaving a store. Just 2 years earlier in 2012, based on the amount of product that was on a truck, it would have taken us 25,227 trips. We saved 9,640 deliveries. It's unbelievable. And now the first, but you really have to work at this because the order of the world is, well, we don't need to become more efficient with logistics. We just need more trucks. That's a simpler, except for writing the check, that's a simpler way to solve the problem. But it's not the best way to solve the problem. Eliminating the waste is the best way to solve the problem. So our company got a lot more efficient, and it's a really good thing we did. Because in 2006, the housing and credit markets in this country crashed, as you know, and they crashed here in Maine. This is housing starts in southern Maine. So in 3 years, our market eroded by 60%. We had all the same customers. And the market was 60% smaller. I think there are two kinds of people in the world, those that know there are forces out there bigger than you, and those that are going to know that there are forces out there that are bigger than you. There are forces out there bigger than the best companies, the strongest communities, and this was one such example. The funny thing to me in hindsight, I began working at our company in the summer of 1991, which for those of you that can go all the way back in your head to that economic cycle was like the beginning of the upturn. And it was a long upturn. It lasted until 2005. So I came to work in 1991, and for 15 years, every year, our sales grew, and we got bigger. And here's the funny, what I think's really funny today, when I look back at it. I thought it was me. We thought it was us. We thought it was us. And I can look at that today and laugh, because it wasn't. Because it wasn't. So this was a lot of things, including stressful. For me, it was stressful. I didn't even realize it at the time that it was stressful. I wasn't walking around saying this was stressful. I was just rugged individualizing like I was taught to do. So this was a period where I would find myself at my office at 6 o'clock on Saturday mornings, 6 o'clock on Sunday mornings. I just put my head down and I worked and I fought. Because we had to change a lot pretty quickly. We had a lot of work to do. As the pilots say, we were coming in hot. We had to change a lot. It was a fast landing. But short story, thanks to a really loyal group of customers, a really loyal, committed group of employees, grit and luck, we came out the other end of this cycle stronger statistically than when we went in. And today our company is putting up records in almost any category that you would measure. But the reason I share that with you, and this is kind of where the story gets personal and I want to share this, is it took a toll. And it wasn't until after it was over that I started to realize it had taken a toll. So Train has a hit song out now that I like. I won't sing it, but there are phrases I like. The core phrase is, we all got bruises. Those bruises, they make for better conversations. So I know I came out of that period with bruises. We all come from a tribe. My tribe, I'm going to expand it one more circle. Maine, forest products industry, men, the tribe I come from. That tribe has been taught for generations not to talk about its bruises. We keep them to ourselves. And in the spirit of P.D. Merrill, I'm revisiting that assumption. I don't think that's right. I don't think that's healthy. I don't think that's the future for men anywhere, is to keep those things to themselves. So I've started, well, really, because it's been therapeutic for me first, and then because I think it's helpful to see another path, I've started becoming really open about my bruises and my journey. Because I think men, very general statement, might do better on that path. So here's my bruise. Here's how it manifested itself. In 2010, I lost my voice. Now, I mean literally, to a rare voice disorder that you have probably never heard of. I certainly hadn't, and no one in the Portland medical community had either. It took a year for me to get diagnosed. I had CAT scans and everything. Lost my voice to a rare disorder called spasmodic dysphonia. If you know spasmodic dysphonia, you could hear it in my voice, and depending on the day you saw me, you were with me, you would definitely notice it. Today, it's pretty good. It's very rare. They estimate maybe 25,000 people in North America have spasmodic dysphonia. And it only affects speech. So what happens? It's neurological. When you go to talk, the muscles around your voice box spasm and they contract. Only when you talk, not when you sing, not when you hum, not when you exercise, not when you eat, only when you talk. And at its worst, you can barely talk. So I've spent years, it might be hard for you to picture right this minute because I've kind of done something that not a lot of people have done, which is get over around it, because it's incurable. Medically speaking, they will say, the first thing the doctor says is you have spasmodic dysphonia. The second thing he or she says is there's no cure. But what it makes you want to do is not talk, because it can be so painful, you don't want to talk. And at its worst, if we were in a restaurant, I would have to, which is kind of fun too, I get to do more of this, I'd have to be right in your ear for you to hear me. Medically, the medical community will say there is no known cause. But it most often comes on to people in midlife, in their 40s. And I know why I got spasmodic dysphonia. I know what my cause was. I had lost myself in my roles of serving and protecting my tribe. And my body and my soul was giving me a very strong warning, possibly, I believe, a final warning, that that was not a winning, healthy, sustainable path, and that I needed to change. So, as big a pain in the neck as spasmodic dysphonia has been for me, I now talk about it as an unbelievable blessing that I'm so glad I got, because it was a wake-up call that forced me to stop, because I couldn't talk, and reassess leadership, management, and my place in the roles I was playing for my tribe. So this is so cool and powerful, I think. If you were running a big organization and you lost your voice, what would you do? Besides freak out at first. But then what would you do? Well, this is what I did. I listened more. I talked less. I asked more questions. I looked at more data. I showed more restraint. I let other people run meetings. I didn't break the silence. I shared responsibility for representing the organization. I picked my spots more carefully. I trusted and empowered others more completely. And I spent more time serving myself to ensure my own personal vitality. And I've since come to see, playfully but seriously, that perhaps every CEO should lose his or her voice. Because I might well have just gotten lucky, but it worked. Could well just be luck. And if it was just luck, it was just luck. Or just timing. But it worked. So my management approach changed. My leadership approach changed. I focused a lot more on myself. And the organization blossomed. We started putting up records for performance. And then we'd break those records. And more importantly, even to me, we became, just last year, even more important than the financial records, we became a best place to work in Maine. So there are 49,000 companies in Maine, 70 last year won the distinction of best place to work. There was one forest products company on the list. You don't find lumber companies on that list. But you do now. And here's what I love. I don't know if you know the Best Place to Work award or organization, but it's really great. It's the criteria is 100% based on third-party confidential employee surveys. So the award is only based on how the people that work there view the company. And they have to rate themselves and their experience as being exceptionally highly engaged and satisfying in order to be a best place to work. So it's not an award where, like, Kevin Hancock writes an essay about why Hancock Lumber is really cool, and then if you wrote a good essay, that's not what this is. This is in the eyes of the people that work there, that they think it's a great place to work. So I was, I feel like I got lucky. Like, I don't feel like I invented this. I feel like my spasmodic dysphonia picked me up and plopped me down in this spot. And as I was grasping for a path, I found this one, and it worked. And then I had another epiphany. And those are rare. It's not like, I mean, who has a lot of epiphanies? Right? So when you have an epiphany, you need to, like, just give me a minute, because I'm having an epiphany. So this is important. So here was the next epiphany I had. Our 24/7 internet-wired, efficiency-driven, bigger, better, more, now, modern world is taking us down. So slowly we can't see it, but it's taking us down. And it's going to crash. The never-ending quest for more is going to crash. That was my epiphany. And when I started looking around, I saw that actually a lot of people were seeing this. one of my favorite writers on the topic calls it the busyness bubble. The nature of bubbles is that some asset is absurdly overvalued until eventually the bubble bursts, and we're left scratching our heads, wondering why we were so irrationally exuberant in the first place. The asset we're overvaluing now is the notion of doing it all, having it all, achieving it all, what Jim Collins calls the undisciplined pursuit of more. So that epiphany led me to give something up. I gave up the pursuit of global business conquest, which I'd actually been on for 20 years. More stores. Why? I don't know. More trucks, more people, more sales, more, bigger, better, more. I gave that up. Didn't give up the pursuit of excellence for the organization we have. Love it. Didn't give up being serious about it. Love it. Not saying we aren't going to continue to grow. We are. But global conquest, I gave up that as a mission. And then I asked myself another P.D. Merrill question, status quo challenging question. What if we used lean Six Sigma efficiency? What if we used it to do less, not more? What if we used lean to put the work back in its place, where it's important but not all consuming? And what if we tried to help everybody on the team, everybody in the company, be in a position to work less and earn more? What if you used efficiency gains to reduce the hours and increase the paycheck? What if you used lean to free capacity, human capacity? For what purpose? Not just to make more widgets. Even if we do make more widgets, that's not the purpose. The purpose of lean, the higher calling of lean, this is what I've come to call it, the higher calling of lean is to free human capacity so people can put the work back in its place and engage life, the world, more broadly, deeply, slowly, and authentically. Using lean to do less, not more. What if we did that? And I got really excited about that. So here's what I did with it. No one else would have done this with it. I went to the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation in the southwest corner of South Dakota. I'll tell you why in a minute, because that's everybody's first question, why? That's what I did. But let me just describe Pine Ridge. It's the biggest, poorest Indian reservation in America. It's poor by reservation standards. It's one of the most isolated places in this country. Nobody goes there. The reservation is 2.2 million acres. If you drop the reservation on the state of Connecticut, it would cover 70% of Connecticut. It's about 2 hours south of Rapid City, just behind the Badlands, and about 6 hours north of Denver, just above the Nebraska Panhandle. It's home of the Oglala Sioux tribe. They're the direct descendants of some of the most famous war chiefs and medicine men in American history. Red Cloud, Crazy Horse, Black Elk. Their band was largely responsible for defeating Custer and the 7th Cavalry on the Little Bighorn River in June of 1876, for which they believe they are still being punished for. They describe their journey through modern American history as from first to worst. The lowest life expectancy in the Western Hemisphere is Haiti. Second is Pine Ridge. Men on average live to be 48. Women on average live to be 52 or 53. The unemployment rate is over 90%. Nobody has a job. There's no infrastructure. You cannot buy diapers on the reservation. You can't go to the movies. You can't go to a bank. You can't go to a car dealership. You can't go to a motel. There is no economic infrastructure there. The median income is $6,000. And nobody even knows about them. We've convinced ourselves, we have a great nation, right? We love this, we love Maine, we talked about that, we love this nation. What makes this nation great, I think, is we can stand back and look in the closets. We can look under the rug, we can look at the hard edges. Things you can't do in every other country in this world. That's what makes us, among other things, in my view, unique and powerful. And I started to take that look. So when you think about it, so we've convinced ourselves that Columbus discovered a new world. National Geographic estimates that at the time of Columbus's arrival, there were 50 to 100 million people in the Americas. And we've convinced ourselves that people who were colonized are in other countries. But the Plains Indians and essentially all native peoples that were survived were colonized. And when you read the story of what happened to them, it's hard to even read it once they were put on the reservations. Hard to even read it. So for generations, up until like the 50s, the government went to Pine Ridge, took your children, took to Indian boarding schools to remake them as white people. That's not like the offhanded purpose. That was the stated purpose. So we're going to cut your hair. We're going to change your dress. If you're caught speaking your language, this could be a 10-year-old girl, if you're caught speaking your language, you're going to be made to kneel on rice on the wooden floor all day. That happened right here. So I went, but I went to Pine Ridge for myself, actually. So I've always, back to my first job when I left, graduated from Bowdoin, I taught history. I've always loved American history, particularly fascinated with the second half of the 19th century when America's Western expansion ran into the Plains Indians. I just kept reading more and more about that period of time. And then I've always loved the American West. Any excuse I've ever found to go there, I've loved. So after I'd had my epiphanies, I'd said to my wife, Allison, I want to go do something just for me. And I didn't know what that was, but we were getting on an airplane, and we picked up National Geographic, and on the cover was a picture of a young Oglala Sioux kid from Pine Ridge riding a horse bareback across a grassy knoll. And I was like, I want to go there. I wonder what life is like there. So I was just going once, just to see it, and I kept a journal. But I was so taken by what I experienced there that I kept going back. I ended up... One trip became six, a journal became a book, and which I just picked up a copy of today. I've started a nonprofit organization called The Seventh Power, and I have all kinds of friends at Pine Ridge. They text me all the time, and that's what I did with Lean. Just one guy from Casco. And it didn't, here's the thing that really struck me too. All that made me a better manager. I wasn't any less committed at all to what I was doing here. It strengthened what I was doing here because what I learned, and I learned this from the from looking at the old ways of the Lakota, very basic notion. When we serve ourselves, we strengthen the tribe. So I found a path to the future at Pine Ridge that I just, again, was not looking for. Before the coming of the Wasichu, which is the term for the white people, the Lakota phrase for white people, before the coming of the Wasichu, They were a strong people. And their organizational model was really interesting. There was almost no central government, which really frustrated like the US government and the great father in Washington, because he would send his emissaries to negotiate and they'd show up and say, well, take me to your chief. And people were like, well, we don't have one. And then negotiators couldn't even get their head around that. But in that model, the individual was the source of power. So there are six sacred rights of the Lakota, but one of which is the vision quest. You probably heard of the notion of a vision quest. So the concept of a vision quest is you leave your tribe for a period of days to sequester yourself in nature, to find your true calling and purpose, and then you are asked to come back and live in accordance with those principles. And it's Rudyard Kipling's concept of the strength of the pack is the wolf. And the notion was, if every individual is doing what fires them up, what they're passionate about, then the tribe will be strong. Fast forward to reservation life, and the model got flipped totally inside out. So the reservation model is you have no power as an individual. You're going to come here. You have to stay here. You cannot leave. But we're going to give you everything you need. We're going to build you your house. We're going to give you your clothes. We're going to give you some farm tools. We're going to build you a school. We're going to build you a church. We're going to provide everything for you. And what amazed me when I went back to Pine Ridge is that's still the way it works. And in that model, they have become a statistical disaster, not just economically, but health and suicide, diabetes, and all of those things. So just kind of quickly moving through that, I want to show you one more thing and then a quick video. So all of that journey just led me to this notion of a new leadership model, where the key skill of leadership is restraint. The objective is to create a culture where you're giving power away, not hoarding it. And you're trying to create an organization where everyone leads, not just a few people, but everyone leads. And the timing of this, again, I feel lucky, but I think that there is a power shift happening on this planet, and it's where partly where the tension resides right now. So this is the Pine Ridge side of it. You don't normally hear business people saying this, but the age of Aquarius has actually dawned. Like that whole 60s crowd was just a little bit ahead of the curve. It hadn't actually dawned yet, but it has now. And it's an age, an astrological age, lasts for a long time, thousands of years. So the transitions from one age to the next are, they're long, and at the front end of the curve, they're really difficult because the structure of one age does not want to let go. So it fights. And if you look around the world now, you can see this. But this is the Aquarian age right here. It is a transition from the organization holding all the power to the individual holding all the power. And I think the businesses or the entities that embrace that transformation can be ahead of the curve like PD and can flourish. And the organizations that fight that are just gonna fight. Whether it's in the Middle East, Pine Ridge, South Dakota, or at Hancock Lumber. And none of that would I have stumbled on if I hadn't lost my voice and gone searching to regain it. Our bodies know, but we don't always listen. So I'd like to I'd like to show you a quick video, 6-minute video, and then we're gonna stop. Okay, I just want to show you some images from what I've experienced at Pine Ridge. So putting the work back in its place so that it's important but not consuming, freeing up all human capacity so everybody can go find their Pine Ridge. That's my thought today. So I'm good. You've been really good to listen to me. I think it's reception time, so the leaders here can decide if we want to do questions here or just visit at the reception. It doesn't matter to me. But I was really honored to speak at PD's event, and thank you for having me.
I think so too, yep.
Thank you for sharing your story with us. Can you share a little bit how this impacted upon your family, you know, as you went to find yourself? Because ultimately, it's about our tribe at home that we're taking care of. Are you willing to share a little bit about that?
Yeah, I think really positively, but it took a lot of trust. I'm really lucky. I know my wife Allison's here, and she went to Pine Ridge with me this fall, last fall for the first time. I'd been there 6 times, and I don't think any of my friends there believed I was actually really married. So when they saw Alice and they're like, oh yeah, you're really married. But no, it's been, you know, I think in our family where you have seen generation after generation grow up and go into the business, that this is really valuable. That this notion that everyone should search for what calls to them. And our 2 daughters and my wife have been really supportive. The management team, that kind of Hancock family, has been really supportive because it didn't, it only strengthened my appreciation of my own family, my own town, my own company, my own commitment to those things. It wasn't that it doesn't have to be or. We can serve ourselves or our tribe. The most powerful word, I think, in the dictionary is and. We can serve ourselves and serve our tribe. We don't have to pick. And I spent a long time feeling like I had to pick, but I didn't.
When you talk with other business leaders, do you feel that they're listening to your message and are open to what you're saying?
yeah, I would say yes. I think, and even more broadly, I think I feel this concept of the busyness bubble resonates with almost everybody. Students, parents, almost everybody. I think everybody has this feeling, you know, never have we been more connected and never have we felt more kind of isolated at the same time. And I think there's people have a sense that something's not quite right. And the frustration you see comes from we can't put our finger on it. Like, what's not quite right? So I have felt like when people sit and think about these concepts, that, yeah, I have found people are open to these ideas.
So in addition to the business concept, what about the concept of the sharing of power? You know, I think that that's pretty radical, and I would expect that some other business leaders would be pretty resistant to that idea.
Yes. So this, that's, I think, what is going to hold up this curve. Because that's what it really takes. It takes whoever holds the power to get in the mindset of wanting to give it away versus collect it. And change would come really slowly to any organization in which the leaders who had the power didn't want to spread it out. So I think that's going to take quite a while. And again, I'm trying to be really humble about this because I don't even know that I would have done it. You follow what I'm saying by that? I kind of got dropped into a place where I had to because of my voice, the blessing of that. And I was willing to listen to what it was telling me, not just fight it. I fought it at first, and then I started listening. And then I was like, oh, this is actually better for everybody. Because the other thing I've seen is people, the people who do the work, they would love to have more authentic responsibility to really set the plans and make the decisions and be responsible for the results and come up with revisions. People will take, well, I often say the boss gets first dibs on all the work. And the organization actually stands around and of course, why wouldn't you? Let's the boss take all the work the boss wants, all the decisions the boss wants, and then they scoop up everything else, and they do that. So you have to, you've got to be in the mindset of wanting to, that notion of an organization where everyone leads. I just think an organization where everyone leads, even though it's an ideal state, will by and large, over an extended period of time, almost always be a similar organization where almost only, where only a few people lead.
Well, logistically speaking, you still have to make sure that once you spread the leadership, they're leading towards where you, kind of the organization wants to go. Did it happen that, to you, that some of the people who are now leading were not following the vision, or?
That's a really good question as well. Did everybody hear that? Could you just say that one more time? Maybe just
sure.
A little
I was wondering if once you spread the power, the leadership responsibilities, if sometimes maybe some on the team were not leading towards the vision, Hancock's vision, mm-hmm. that everybody agreed to or that it was the best for everybody. How did you handle that?
That's a really good question. So I think an organization that's going to really push power out has to invest a lot of time in talking about what the values are, the core values are, that are there to guide decision making, and what the core kind of macro objectives are that will guide decision making, and that has to be a constant conversation so that everybody knows. But I've found that if it's a constant conversation and it's a sensible set of values that has consensus behind it, that people, people are great. That's the simple, you know, people want to do a good job and they want to get behind smart, sensible, holistic values, and that they'll actually run with it. And yeah, you may get a few people that try to stray out of bounds, but it's almost easier in this model because the entire organization's keeping everybody on the same path. Because if you stray from those values, you start to look a little weird in the organization because that's not what everybody else is doing. So it kind of self, I don't want polices is a bad word, but you know what I'm trying to say? It kind of self-powers, sustains itself.
Thank you.
At lunch, I heard you talking about the spirituality, the notion of the Lakotas, and I wonder if you just used the word holistic in relation to your own company, and I see a connection between the two. I wonder if you'd share that spirituality you saw.
I'm so glad you brought that back up. So the Lakota, the core. At the core of Lakota spirituality is this notion that they use a couple of phrases. All things are one thing. All things are related. So their spirituality and what we might think of as environmentalism are not two different things, they're the same thing. And the concept is that everything that lives, has lived, is living, or shall live, all came from and is going to return to the same earth. And that therefore, even logically, it's all related. It's all the same particles and substances, and was given life by the same collection of powers, sun and oxygen and soil, and that everything is related, truly related. So they talk, even to this day, about their four-legged brothers, the buffalo, the elk, the deer, the antelope, which in our culture sounds, it's so different. In our culture, that's like, it's almost like comical. I mean, it's just so far from kind of mainstream thinking. But they talk about it as being real, that no, four-legged brothers, real, brothers, sisters. And they don't think of the four-leggeds as being a subspecies, as being inferior, as being lesser, as being only there to serve mankind. They truly think that all things are one thing, and that therefore all peoples are related. And this even is, you know, the science on this, which is not perfect, but it's pretty well substantiated that scientifically, and according to the record, all humans came out of Africa and populated the world and went east and west and north and met again with Columbus, not thinking they were actually related, but they were. So yeah, this notion that you can totally translate that back into thinking about an organization, right? Which is an organization that serves everyone.
Thank you very much for your talk. Some very powerful themes and fascinating material that you've shared with us. I have a question about your diagram up there, the power shift that you have talked about, and I'm wondering where, in your view, the category or the reality of something called community fits or doesn't fit, and how your shifting, your vision of power shifting back to the individual relates to what you started with of what this country has been built on and which has been problematic, as you've said, of rugged individualism. So I guess two questions. Where do you see community fitting, and how does your vision of shifting power to individuals differ from rugged individualism?
Yeah, great questions. I think serving yourself strengthens your connection to your tribe. So again, just one quick example back to Lakota culture. So if a warrior took down a buffalo, that buffalo belonged to the entire tribe and was shared amongst the entire tribe. So what I found, like just in my own example, which is I guess how I'm envisioning the answer to your question, is that for me, being around a company and a family that encouraged me to express myself more freely in ways that were calling to me, strengthened my love, my already high love of that family, my family, those people, that company. And this notion that when people are in a place where they feel like they can really express themselves, be themselves, where they can individuate, that it doesn't lessen their loyalty to the community, it strengthens it. That's what I think. That's what's happened to me.
Kevin, thank you very much. It's been a very excellent talk.
You're welcome. Thank you.